all your life. Not all your love, all your hate, all your memory, all your pain. It was all the same thing. It was all the same dream, a dream that you had inside a locked room. A dream about being a person.
It's been over 3 years since the premiere of True Detective, and no other show since has upheld the excellence in storytelling throughout an entire season. Plot points that trap the detective genre in its formulaic proceedings were given a complete overhaul, along with Matthew McConaughey and Woody Harrelson, who play the two central leads of Russ and Marty. What Nick Pizzolatto crafted here is a genre-defining classic that managed to entertain audiences with an original narrative, flawed characters, and a dark atmosphere this late in the genre. Tackling the complex ideas of humanity's fall from grace and one's connection with the supernatural all hinge on the two expertly written characters at the forefront. They bring out their pessimism and hypocrisy as they connect with society. But what Pizzolatto more importantly dwells on is that the demonic forces in the surroundings shape the desires of the detectives. In my eyes, the main attraction of this story is that we're presented with two men who aren't all good and all bad. They constantly walk the fine lines of morality, as they show sparks of heroism and villainy within themselves. Characters such as Tony Soprano, Walter White, and Don Draper offer their complex take on the nature of men during the mid-2000s, making them the most well-written and revered characters in the golden era of television. True Detective, meanwhile, takes elements from these personalities and applies them to these two deeply wounded central characters. And what Pizzolatto does is explore two central conflicts. The crisis of masculinity, pertaining to Marty's marriage, fatherhood, infidelity, and the crisis of humanity seen through the eyes of Russ' nihilism, depression, obsession, and addiction with the murder case. With Marty, he internalizes the sorrows he has in his life, the adultery he commits, the horrors of his work, and puts on a happy facade, even though he considers himself to be a Christian. There's an inherent sadness that surrounds his character, and that's played excellently by Woody Harrelson, who gives an effective yet understated performance, using subtlety to show the cracks of his wounded persona. Rust has a similar but albeit different circumstance. His daughter was taken away from him. He perceives the world as a realm of endless suffering, and that life is meaningless, plagued with no redeeming qualities. Born from that pain is his nihilism, a philosophical outlook popularized by Friedrich Nietzsche, where one focuses on the meaninglessness of life and that nothing has intrinsic value, and we're made clear of this in the opening scenes.
I think human consciousness was a tragic misstep in evolution. We became too self-aware. Nature created an aspect of nature separate from itself. We are creatures that should not exist by natural law.
Where did this outlook come from? With the death of his daughter, his divorce, his time undercover? The first crime scene shows off how the pair approached their work. Marty cares only by the physicality of the murders. He just walks around and takes pictures, following the normal procedures a detective might take, while Rust fully immerses himself in the motives and psyche of the killers. It reflects their personalities. Marty takes things at face value because he just wants to get on with life. He never puts the effort into dealing with his daughters because he wants the least input as possible. Rust has a different attitude about him. His instincts are to question and hypothesize everything he interacts with, especially the ritualistic elements of the first crime scene. The little faith he has in humanity really shines through in his work, as he likens his disdain for humanity with the killer's attitudes. The title sequence alone gives us an essence of the brooding tone, the disturbed characters, and the tortured environments.
We're really lucky because Nick Pizzolatto, the showrunner, has this great, deep, intelligent knowledge of the world he's creating. Nick said to us that what he was trying to do was look at the poisoned, broken landscapes of Louisiana and use them as a metaphor for the poisoned, broken characters, people who'd been exploited, people who'd been polluted and used up.
Images that convey internal division, with partial portraits split by the toxic, industrial elements, linger in the viewer's subconscious as they proceed to watch these elements unfold. There's an influence of cosmic horror throughout, a genre popularized by H.P. Lovecraft, which explores the horrors of the unknown, of the madness and evil from other dimensions that we as humans cannot fully comprehend. It's the idea that the ordinary life we take for granted is nothing compared to a reality so abstract and alien that even thinking about it will make a person go insane. To quote the man himself, "The basis of all true cosmic horror is violation of the order of nature, and the profoundest violations are always the least concrete and describable." We can observe this idea in the landscapes of Louisiana, as the environmental decay and gradual deterioration seeps its way into the people, culture, and society. Just like the novel Blood Meridian, it feels like the antagonist is a vibe, the age, something infernal in the environment. Kari Fukunaga chose wisely to position these characters in hostile surroundings, as if the world is closing in around them, to truly represent nature in a damning way. Russ's bare apartment clearly shows his distance from warmth and connection, as his work is everything he has. We get a feeling that his mental health has taken a dip after seeing random hallucinations. They're shown with such abstract qualities that to fully understand them, we need to properly deconstruct Russ's thought process. The cults, the maze at the end, the decency in people being corrupted by evil, all made the show seem straight out of a Lovecraft story. As the show led up to its finale, many people were obsessing over the small details in order to crack the case, which is why many were disappointed to find a stereotypical redneck at the end of the trail. I thought this was perfect because I was expecting some outwardly supernatural occurrence to take place, but instead, the monster they've been tracking was just a disturbed, troubled man being controlled by other people. And that was the whole point. Even people have the capacity for evil that Lovecraft's monsters do. The term psychosphere is used by Rust early on.
I got a bad taste in my mouth out here. Aluminum. Ash. Like you can smell the psychosphere.
This term again originates from the creations of H.P. Lovecraft, which describes the area of collective consciousness where someone's thoughts and feelings are projected, and anyone in the vicinity can access these. This is what Russ thinks compels people to commit savagery. He depicts the psychosphere as being poisonous and widespread, and on some level, he even embraces the darkness. Maybe this is why he sees those cryptic visions, has the ability to read people in a few seconds, and can seemingly taste colours.
Just when I thought he couldn't get any stranger.
Are you serious?
He tastes colours.
So, what is synesthesia?
Synesthesia. It's a misalignment of synaptic receptors and triggers, alkalized colors, certain metallics. It's a type of hypersensitivity.
The slow, almost meditative camera movements help highlight the symbols, pentagrams, and the foul atmosphere that seeps its way into the people. The mysterious occult love to revel in this ambience, while the audience can see the deteriorating effects it has on Marty's family over the course of 8 episodes. The corruption of the daughters, Marty giving into temptations, and Maggie using Russ to feel better about herself, all feels like an unseen force slowly picking apart the idea of unity and happiness, and the souls being constantly tainted over time. The detective's relationship harkens back to the poem titled Epic of Gilgamesh, a series of fragmented tablets dating back to 2100 BC that chronicles the friendship of Enkidu and Gilgamesh. Being the earliest surviving works of great literature, it created the basis of the dynamic duo archetype, where one figure has to help the other during a time of hardship, to gift each other their own qualities, and to work for the betterment of society. Marty can function in the real world. He is simple, direct, and lustful as he is entertained by the simple pleasures in life. He serves as a balancing companion to Rust, who must connect with his world. Rust by himself would just fall into a continuous spiral of depression and alcoholism, but having Marty by his side, he deals with real, physical problems, enables Russ to have somewhat of a clear mindset over the course of the case. It's incredibly satisfying to see his complete arc in the final scene. Marty is succeeding in giving Russ the feeling of becoming not only a great man, but a hero. You might think Marty is a better man in this archetype, but him alone isn't worth telling a story. To highlight the sentiment, Peter Lutton never flinches away from plunging the two detectives into the darkest aspects of human nature. The show had to build the dark as being absolute and unconditional, to bring us, the audience, into the mental state of Rust. He doesn't find happiness in the thought of an afterlife. He finds solace that we came from the darkness and will end in darkness, but in that life, we fight for the light. Much has been said of Rust's infamous monologues. They're beautifully expressed, yet undeniably grim in nature.
Someone once told me time is a flat circle. Everything we've ever done or will do, we're gonna do over and over and over again.
Russ believes we are stuck in a continuum that we cannot break out of. He believes it's human nature to do the same thing repeatedly, and that these events aren't as poignant as we think they are. Every murder victim, everyone who suffers from disease or poverty or injury, is doomed to repeat the cycle of their existence. Russ's horror emerges from the awareness of being stuck in a loop knowing that human existence in the end is hopeless. We think that the world revolves around us, living for a certain identity, but in reality, we're just a species walking towards our extinction. It's this grim understanding that controls the way he holds himself during the interviews. When Marty carries out an act that stimulates his nihilism, Russ says,
"What do we do, Russ?"
"Oh, fuck him. Good to see you commit to something."
The dialogue between Russ and Marty during the church scene sheds some light on Russ's opinion surrounding religion, on how one's actions are morphed by fictitious beliefs.
"It could be a fucking freak show of murder and debauchery, and you know it.
If the only thing keeping a person decent is the expectation of divine reward, then brother, that person is a piece of shit."
Russ employs similar rhetorical strategies during interrogations, and recognizes religion as a specific tool to be used when necessary.
"You got one way out, and it's through the grace of God. You are only out of the Lord made you."
The criminal thinks he's given himself over to a larger truth, but it's just another day for Russ in the interrogation room. As a person who straddles a line between atheism and agnosticism, Russ feels no shame in involving religion as a tactic, because the only larger truth he believes in is nothingness. However, despite Russ's somber mood throughout, he continues to fight for the lives he claims are meaningless. He wants to solve the murders, he wants to stop mothers who kill children, but he still couldn't figure out why he wants this. It's only after the battle with Errol, the swirling vortex of nothingness, and the near-death experience, is he able to see the truth. Even with the overwhelming presence of darkness in this world, despite all the pain a soul is subjected to, the light that makes it worthwhile is still there. The show ends with Rust having an epiphany.
"I could feel, man. I knew my daughter waited for me."
He sees the light because, for a moment, he saw the spirit world, where his dead daughter waited for him. He realizes that beyond this world, full of sadistic killers and toxic environments, that there is another dimension, an eternal one, where those people have no power at all, and that place is always worth fighting for. There was no mind-blowing plot twist, because that wasn't the point. We had already gone through the meat of the story with the two detectives, and their interactions with others is what we should have noticed. It's about the revelation of real evil and monsters in our society, about the unseen forces that plague the landscapes of Louisiana. That's where Russ and Marty come in, two individuals who act as the conduit between the audience and the world Peter Lahti so painstakingly created. The natural development of characters is what drives the plot forward. Their struggles, the insecure feelings in this world, and the fears of failure. These obstacles are brought to the forefront to make Rust and Marty two of the most memorable TV characters in recent memory. There were many reasons why season 2 faltered, but my main issue was the lack of focus between characters. Five characters that weren't given enough emotional weight led to the season's story threads and overall character arcs coming off as severely underwhelming. Here's hoping that Peter Lahti reins in on creating engaging characters for season 3, while having a sense of uniqueness akin to the ambience created in season 1. What I took away from this show is coming to terms with grief, by fighting through the dark times that lie ahead of us, even for an ounce of happiness. These 8 episodes became a transformative parable for the medium, an introspective tale that will linger in the subconscious of our memories for the years ahead.
Writing those scripts was really like going through the eye of a needle. You know, there was nothing to do but to keep going forward, no matter what. And then to actually have the great fortune of seeing great actors bring these roles to life and to see it realized, I would say absolutely the entire process changed me.